Good morning. Today is Sunday, May 2nd, the first Sunday of the month. As such, here at Olivet Schwenkfelder United Church of Christ, we celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. In this place, communion is an open table. Any and all are welcome to partake, whether or not you're a member. I do ask that you take an opportunity now to get your communion elements ready. They might be prepackaged communion from our drive-in blessing box, or any kind of bread or cracker you have at the house. Perhaps you have some wine or juice. Have faith that no matter what elements you use this morning, the Holy Spirit has the power to transform them and us in the breaking of the bread and wine. Good morning. I'm Reverend Leslie Mamas with Olivet Schwenkfelder United Church of Christ, an open and affirming community of faith where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome with us. We do have a few announcements today. The first, it has been a blustery and windy past few days. Here in our sanctuary, we actually have a large skylight. If during the course of this video worship service, you notice some background noise or banging, it's the wind on that skylight. We are continuing to have drive-in worship every Sunday morning at 10:15 a.m. We ask that you arrive 10 to 15 minutes early and make sure to bring a mask. This will be especially important beginning next Sunday, May 9th, when we will be transitioning to worshiping outside of our vehicles. If you would like, you may remain in your vehicle and continue to hear the service over your car's radio. However, you may also bring a lawn chair and sit near your vehicle in the parking lot, enjoying the beautiful spring weather and the company of your fellow worshipers. We do have a number of guidelines regarding the new out-of-car worship, including but not limited to staying within an arm's reach of your car and making sure to wear a mask anytime you're outside of the vehicle. Once again, whether you plan on worshiping inside your car or setting up a lawn chair in our parking lot, please arrive 10 to 15 minutes early. Every Wednesday night, we do have two Zoom ministry opportunities. The first is a Bible study. We are currently doing Paul's Fruits of the Spirit as found in Galatians. That occurs at 6 p.m. and you can call in on a telephone or a digital device. We also have a 7 p.m. prayer group. All are welcome, and we encourage you to join us as we share our journeys together and any prayer requests we may have. We are continuing to collect items for Chester County Migrant Ministries. We are collecting both new blankets and toiletries, that is, health kit items. We need these within the next 2 weeks, so act fast and drop them off in our mission donation bin just outside our church entrance. Seeing as there are no other announcements to share, let us be in the spirit of worship on this Communion Sunday. Hear these words from Psalm 22. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. At this time, we will together enjoy our first hymn, pre-recorded by our Director of Music Ministries, Tony Gordorici. Thank you. pray together. Holy God, Alpha and Omega, beginning and end, inspire new beginnings in us today. Set our eyes on you. Through our worship, renew our resolve to be faithful disciples. Move us to love this world the way Christ loved. Amen. We are, in fact, disciples of the risen Lord, called, commissioned, and yet we fall short. Join me now as together we confess to God our sins. Merciful God, we confess that we often have failed to be loving, that we often have taken for granted the people for whom we care the most. We selfishly neglect and strain the bonds that unite us with others. We hurt those who love us, and we withdraw from the community that encircles us. Forgive us. Renew within us an affectionate spirit. Enrich our lives with your gracious gift of love, so that we may embrace others with the same love. Amen. The good news of Christ is that nothing, not heights, depths, rulers, things present, nor things to come, can keep us from the love of God. In the name of Christ Jesus, our sins are forgiven. At this time, let us enjoy an anthem prepared by beloved members of this congregation. Moment to prepare our hearts and minds for God's truth in the scriptures. Amen. Our first lesson comes from the letter of 1 John chapter 4 verses 7 through 21. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God,
and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. Those who say, I love God, but hate their brothers and sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. Our gospel lesson comes from John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. Here are these words. Christ said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In both of our scriptures this morning, we hear a lot of abiding. In both the letter from 1 John and our Gospel of John, we hear the word abide over and over again. John 15:4, abide in me as I abide in you. Or rather, a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine. Those who abide in me, whoever does not abide in me. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, abide. What does that word truly mean? Well, it means to remain, to continue, to endure, to sustain. And that's all well and good, but what does that look like? What does all of this abiding mean? Well, 1 John 4:16 reads, God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Right? God is love, and those who remain in love, who endure in love, are also remaining as part of God. And God remains and endures within them. And I think we mostly all know this, at least on some level. Think about that old hymn that goes, they will know we are Christians by our love. They will know we are Christians by our love. You know, it's not they will know we are Christians by our righteous indignation. It doesn't sing they will know we are Christians by our moral superiority, or that they will know we are Christians by our dislike of change, by our Sunday morning rituals, or by our at times bad praise music. No. The hymn says they will know we are Christians by our love. And 1 John 4:12 actually tells us how to love. It reads, no one has ever seen God, But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. That's a very significant scripture. It says, no one has seen God, well, except for Moses and Jesus. But the fact remains, just like the wind that we may be experiencing this morning, we can't see God. We know God's there, but we can't see God. How many of you have ever been asked, or yourself asked, how do you know that God really exists if you can't see or hear or touch God? And that's a valid question. You know, it's a huge stumbling block for some people. Some people need that tangible evidence, that proof. They need to be able to see and hear and touch in order to believe. But if we follow the logic of 1 John 14, no one can see God, but we know that God is love. So if we love one another, God lives in us. Since God is love, if we love one another, we are experiencing God. So what's the closest thing anyone's going to get to seeing God? Well, according to the scripture this morning, it's seeing how loving we behave, how unusually and radically loving we are capable of being. And to be honest, we are living in a day and age where there isn't so much unusual and radical love. We think about our personal relationships. The average person has a dispute or grudge or unhealthy relationship with a family member, so they cut them off. They say, I'm not going to take this person's calls anymore. I'm not going to invite them to family gatherings anymore. If this person is going to treat me poorly, they can forget about coming over for Thanksgiving. It's a tit for tat. There's a bit of vengeance there. They hurt me, so I am going to hurt them. We hear and perhaps have experienced someone who was not there for us. And so now that they are in need, we cut them out of the picture to let them feel like, let them experience loneliness. They never cared, so why should we care? It's a very natural thing for us humans. We tend to be very tit for tat. When loving someone would either be too painful or, honestly, too much work, we decide it's just not worth the effort. How many of us have a relative that we leave off the Christmas card list on purpose to make a point? How many of us have that family member who the rest of the family always talks about in his or her absence? Brings us back to those three simple questions. Is it true? Is it kind? Is it necessary? We show love or lack of love in the way we speak or don't speak about others. This is how we behave as human beings out there in the secular world. If loving is too risky, if loving takes too much energy or hard work, we don't bother with it. And if it's easier to be angry, and it's often easier to be angry, well then, we don't love. But that's not how we Christians are supposed to be in the world. The point is that as Christians, we are supposed to put in the effort an average person might not. We forgive others even when there's no personal benefit to us in doing so. Now let me repeat that, because in case you haven't noticed, usually folks only forgive when they get something out of it themselves. Forgiveness should be its own reward, its own virtue. We should forgive not because someone else deserves to be forgiven, but because it's what God requires of us. You know, the way people see God is to see us acting loving, abiding in love, keeping our relationships healthy, forgiving, letting bygones be bygones, even when there seems to be no good reason for doing so. The way that people see God is by seeing us choosing our words carefully, being extraordinarily generous. The reason we love is because love itself is God, and God is present in our loving. And what about our most intimate relationships? We want others, non-Christians, folks out there who haven't found Christ, we want them to look at the ways that we communicate, forgive, and abide with one another. And we want them out there to say, wow, what's up with that? What do they have going on in their lives that I and my relationships lack? But that whole know God through their love thing doesn't end with just our families or our church families. Think for a moment what the average person's response would be to any given situation in our society. Whether it's an earthquake hitting a far-off country where they don't know anyone. A lot of times folks will just turn off the news channel and say, well, that's horrible. I feel bad for those suffering people. But someone abiding in love might actually get up and donate a few dollars to the Red Cross to help. Maybe there are people taking to the streets, people of color and allies, people, youth, who are in pain, who are frustrated, who are feeling injustice. Well, the average person might automatically condemn, saying that's not how we solve problems. But a person abiding in love asks, why are you in so much anger and pain? What experiences have they had that I have not had, that I may not truly understand? How do we begin to make things better? That's what somebody abiding in love would say. They don't judge. They don't get angry. They don't look down their nose at those folks. They say, wow, what life experience have you had that I have not? Teach me that I may help make it better. An average person would say, me and my own are the most important. We come first. Particularly in the midst of pandemic. My own comfort, my own rights come first. Whereas somebody abiding in love knows that everyone counts. Everyone matters. And if wearing a mask, getting a shot, or avoiding that big graduation party means protecting someone else, well, that is abiding in love. It is selfless. Abiding means to endure, as we said. Abiding means to sustain. Sharing an act of love here and there, it's great, but that's not what abiding is. To truly have God in us, we need to constantly be living out of an unusual and noteworthy place of love. We need to be enduring in love. We need to catch ourselves. We need to catch ourselves when our words are not true, kind, and necessary. We need to catch ourselves when we look at folks and immediately judge their actions or their value without asking empathetically what their journey has been like, what we might not know or understand. Abiding in love means continuing on even when it's tiresome, even when we feel done. Abiding in love means continuing to give of ourselves in generosity, humility. And that's the only way that the average person out there on the streets will take notice. The only way that they will be able to see God. How about you and I work this week and in the weeks ahead by being God to others so that they may know Christ and God in the way that we love. Amen. Let us turn our hearts to God in prayer. We begin this day by praying for those affected by natural disasters and extreme climate events, the many who have experienced storms here in our nation this week, as well as disasters around the globe. We continue to pray for those dealing with the COVID pandemic, whether it is our doctors and nurses, whether it's our first responders, the volunteers giving shots, or those who are bravely willing to get them for the sake of others. We continue to pray this day for all of the many hurts in our country and world, for those who have fled violence and are now at our borders seeking a home and safety, for those who have experienced violence this week, particularly gun violence. We continue to pray for those who are finding it difficult in isolation and loneliness, those who may be grieving, those who cannot be with us in person. Oh God, we know that you are love, and that as love you are poured forth each and every time we pray for one another. As such, hear our prayers of intercession this day. Oh God, we pray for our world, our nation, and its leaders, and we ask that you bless them with empathy, hospitality, humility, and generosity. God, this day we ask that you continue to pour out healing in body for those who are sick or suffering in any way, that you pour out healing in mind and spirit for those dealing with depression or anxiety, thoughts of suicide, or the demons of addiction. Oh Lord, we ask that you continue to abide in us, that we may bear fruit in this world. Help us to do good in the things we say and do, building up one another rather than tearing one another down. Be present this day and in the days ahead. We pray in the name of Christ, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, if you have not yet gathered your communion elements, please feel free to pause our worship video so that you are prepared to commune right along with us. Now take the supper of the Lord to your comfort in faith and thanksgiving. Come not because you must, but because
because you may.
Come to testify not that you are righteous, but that you sincerely desire to be God's true disciples. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because you are worthy of heaven's rewards, but because you stand in need of God's mercy and pardon. God be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God Most High. Almighty God, under whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worship your holy name. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We remember that on the night of his betrayal and desertion, on the night of his arrest, Christ had gathered the 12 to the upper room. Around the table, he blessed the bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you." In the same way, he poured out the fruit of the vine, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood which is shed for you. Do this as often as you eat and drink it in remembrance of me. Consecrate, therefore, by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine, and bless us all, that as we share them this day, we might be united with one another, Christ and Christians in every time and place. Amen. This is the body of Christ broken for each and every one of us. Take and eat. And this is the cup of salvation poured out for every single one of us. Take and drink. Having shared in this holy meal, let us give thanks to God. Bountiful God, we give you thanks that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. At this time, let us enjoy together our final hymn. nourished together. Let us be faithful in our time apart. Let us love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of God's Holy Spirit. Amen.